Shalom, guys. Welcome back to another episode of Yashavu Ministry with Casa de Israel Yarah. I thank you, appreciate you for being there. Thank you for the support. Like I always say, like, subscribe, questions, concerns, put them in the comment section down below. So, let's do a Torah blessing and let's get started with this week's Torah portion. Baruch atah Adonai ha'orah, baruch Adonai ha'orah le'olam ba'eh, baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech ha'olam, asher b'harbanu mikol ha'amim, benatan lanu et torato, baruch atah Adonai noten ha'torah. Bless Adonai who is blessed. Bless Adonai who is blessed now and forever. Blessed are you, Adonai, our God, sovereign of the universe, who has chosen us from among the peoples, has given us the Torah. Blessed are you, Adonai, who gives the Torah. Amen. So, this week's Torah portion is Tavo. So, let's get started. Enter. Last week was Kitetse, when you go out. Now, last week we talked about 74 commandments out of the 613. This week's Torah portion talks about the Bikurim, the tithe, and also it talks about the blessings and the curses put on Mount Ebal and Mount Gerizim. And it's the finality of the structure of the covenant, right? In a vassal and suzerain treaty, this is one of the clauses that is very important. Right, because if you do good, this will happen, and if you do bad, all these things will happen, right? And it gives you the opportunity to understand that you choose to do good or do bad. But like I said, this week's Torah portion is Tavo. So let's get started in Deuteronomy 26, and we'll go on from there. But Deuteronomy 26 starts off like this: Vahaya Tavo el haaretz asher Adonai elocheha. Noten lecha nahala vi rista waya shata ba. And in English, it says the following: then it shall be when you enter the land which the Lord your God gives you as an inheritance, and you possess it and live in it, that you shall take some of the first fruit of all the produce of the ground which you bring from the land that the Lord your God gives you, and you shall put it in a basket. Go to the place where the Lord your God chooses to establish his name. You shall go to the priest who is in office at the time and say to him, I declare this day to the Lord, my Elohim, that I have entered the land which Adonai swore to our fathers to give us. Then the priest shall take the basket from your hand and sit it down before the altar of the Lord your God. You shall answer and say before the Lord your God, my father was a wandering Aramean. He went down to Egypt, sojourned there, few in number, but there he became a great, mighty, and populous nation. And the Egyptians treated us harshly and afflicted us and imposed hard labor on us. Then we cried out to the Lord and the God of our fathers, and the Lord heard our voice and saw our affliction and in our toil and our oppression. And the Lord brought us out of the land of Egypt with a mighty hand and outstretched arm and with great terror. And with signs of wonders, and he has brought us to this place. He has given us this land, a land flowing with milk and honey. Now behold, I have brought the first of the produce of the ground, which you, Adonai, have given me. And you shall set it before the Lord your God and worship before the Lord your God. And you and the Levite and the alien who is among you shall rejoice in the good which the Lord your God has given you. So this is the command, right? You bring the first fruits of your produce, basically remembering where you came from and where Elohim has brought you to. And remember that when I told you when we began studying the book of Devarim, Deuteronomy is the biggest word that is in this Torah portion and in the book is remember, right? You can't forget the past. The past gives you the answer to why you are where you are right now, positive or negative. At the end of the day, whatever you lived is of what you are today. So you have to be thankful to Elohim because he might have taken you from somewhere that you did not expect to get out, and he has blessed you and miraculously has brought you to this day in front of him, right? And this is what the people are understanding, right? They were in Egypt, enslaved, Their father was an Aramean. He was wandering in the desert, and eventually he became a mighty nation based on the promises that Elohim has given them, and he has fulfilled them in the people, right? So, Kitabo, Deuteronomy chapter 26, verse 1 to Deuteronomy 29, verse 9, okay? And for the Haftorah of the prophet's portion is Isaiah chapter 60, verse 1 through 22. And for the New Testament or Renewed Testament, Brit Chadasha, is Luke chapter 24, verse 44 to 53. Verses 1 through 15 prescribe a liturgical declaration that the farmer is to recite when he brings the first fruit to the temple, right? Now, the temple is where eventually we understand that Elohim establishes his sacrificial system and where his Levitical priesthood eventually does these offerings after the feast or during the feast, right? That they go up and commemorate, okay? So now, Deuteronomy 16 says the following, right? It says, 3 times a year, all your males shall appear before the Lord your God in the place which he chooses at the Feast of Unleavened Bread, at the Feast of Weeks, at the Feast of Booths, and they shall not appear before the Lord empty-handed. Every man shall give as he is able, according to the blessing of the Lord your God, which he has given you. Now, various biblical laws and stories refer to in ancient Israel's crops and harvest, right? The feast, everything that we celebrate from Passover all the way to Sukkot has to do with the land producing, right? Now, in the context of Israel, they entered the land that they were promised. Elohim manifests himself in this land. He provides for them, and they, in return, demonstrate the gratitude and the awareness and consciousness that he has given them this blessing, right? It hasn't come from their hands. It hasn't come from their might. Everything that has happened is because they have obeyed Elohim, and Elohim has given them and blessed them, okay? Now, major crops of the land are listed in Deuteronomy chapter 8, verse 8, which are wheat, barley, grapes, figs, pomegranates, olives, and honey, right? It says there, verse 7, for the Lord your God is bringing you into a good land, a land of brooks of water, fountains, and springs, flowing forth in valleys and hills, a land of wheat, barley, vines, fig trees, pomegranates, a land of olive oil and honey, okay? Now, the spring harvest, or the spring festivals, which encompass the Pesach, or Passover, unleavened bread, and the Feast of Weeks, or Shavuot. These spring festivals, or the harvest during this time, right, gave various herbs and legumes, and were harvested in spring. But the most important spring crops were cereals, barley, and wheat. Spring ritual took particular note of the cereals. Newly harvested grain could not be eaten until first fruits of grain had been offered on the day after the Shabbat, the festival of unleavened bread, right? This is in Leviticus chapter 23, verse 9 through 14. Now, Pentecost or Shavuot, right? Near the end of the grain harvest, including grain loaves, offerings, which is in verse 16, 17, and Pentecost, or Shavuot, was also called the Feast of Harvest. Barley and wheat were planted in autumn and ripened in spring. Barley matured faster and would be harvested sooner. The first fruit of grain offered during the Feast of Unleavened Bread will have been barley. So that's the first fruits that are offered in this agricultural cycle during the festivals. Barley, the first fruits, okay? They were the ones that mature faster, so they were the ones that were offered first. Now, wheat ripens later than barley, right? In Galilee, for example, part of the grain harvest will be completed after Shavuot or Pentecost, especially in years in which Pentecost came as early as mid-May. Even though all the crop might not be harvested by Shavuot, Pentecost celebrated it, the entire grain harvest, including the small amount of grain to be harvested shortly after the festival. So, the fall festivals or the summer harvest are part of these festivals, which are Rosh Hashanah, which is an appointed time, and Yom Kippur, which is an appointed time. And the festival itself, where you go up, is on Sukkot. And so For, you know, after Pentecost, most of the harvest was fruit, grapes, olives, dates, figs, pomegranates, numerous fruits, seeds, vegetables of a lesser importance, okay? Now, this is like a calendar that I found of around what time, what certain produce would grow, right? Understanding the cycle being followed. Bikurim. This is from the Mishnah. Yes. Now you'll be like, oh, you Judaizer. No, just the Mishnah gives you certain things that they did in the time recorded to celebrate and commemorate the Bikurim, which is the first fruit, which is what we're talking about, okay? So they say the pilgrims that brought the Bikurim to the temple were obligated to recite the declaration, which is what we read in Deuteronomy chapter 26, also known as the Avowal, set forth in Deuteronomy, right? And this is in Bikurim, in the Mishnah 3:6. Native-born Israelites and proselytes will bring the Bikurim and will say the vow, but the women who brought the Bikurim were not permitted to say the vow since they were unable to claim inheritance in the land and banquet onto the tribes by their male lineage. The vow was incorporated into a beautiful and grand festive celebration with procession of pilgrims marching up to Jerusalem and then the temple with gold and silver and willow baskets to which live doves were tied. The pilgrims were led by the flutists to the city of Jerusalem, where they were greeted by dignitaries. The procession would then resume with the flutists and lead until the Temple Mount, where the Levites would break out in song. The doves were then given as sacrificial offerings, and the declaration would be made before the priest while the basket was still in the pilgrim's shoulder. After the basket was presented to the priest, it was placed by the altar, and the pilgrims will bow and leave. After all we read, what is the point? Like, what's the purpose of bringing the first fruits? Honor the Lord with your wealth, with the first fruits of all your crops. Then your barns will be filled to the overflowing, and your vats will be brimmed over the new wine. Does that mean, oh, message of prosperity? No, it doesn't mean that. It means that you have to understand that Elohim is guiding you. Just like the people. People were being guided by Elohim. They were in bondage. They were in Egypt. They were being oppressed. They cried out. Elohim saved them. Extracted them from Egypt. Delivered them to the land promised to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Their father, Abraham, left everything he had to go into the wilderness because Elohim promised them a great nation. Like the sand in the sea, like the stars in the heavens, right? So all of this is a fulfillment. He says, when you go into the land, understand that you have fulfilled the promise I made to your fathers. And when you're in the land and you're enjoying the fruit, and I have established the place where you will worship me and bring offerings to me, remember that the only reason why you're here is because of the past, what you went through, what you have overcame with me guiding you. Okay, now this is understanding that the people are in Canaan, where before they are overtaking it, there's Canaanites, there is Hittites, there's a bunch of nations in that land that worship other gods of fertility, right, that they believe give them rain and then give them crops. And so Israel is going to depend on one God who does everything. And they have to acknowledge that because they have seen the proof and the miracles and the deliverance to the land. Okay, now the proverb says wealth, right? And your barns will be filled. But Proverbs 3 says a lot more, and we're going to read it. Okay, I just want you to read it because I want you to understand the context of the proverb. Because people take it out of context, so let's go. Proverbs says the following. My son, do not forget my teaching, but let your heart keep my commandments, for the length of days and years of life and peace, they will add up to you. Do not let the kindness and truth leave you. Bind them around your neck. Write them on the tablet of your heart, so you will find favor and good repute in the sight of God and men. Trust in Adonai with all your heart, and do not lean on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him, and he will make you your path straight. Do not be wise in your own eyes. Fear the Lord and turn away from evil. It will be healing to your body and a refreshment to your bones. Honor the Lord from your wealth, from the first fruit of your produce, so your barns will be filled with plenty and your vats will be overflow with new wine. My son, do not reject the discipline of the Lord or loathe his reproof. For whom the Lord loves, he reproves, even as a father corrects the son in whom he delights. How blessed is the man who finds wisdom, and the man who gains understanding, for her profit is better than the profit of silver, and her gain better than fine gold. She's more precious than jewels, and nothing you desire compares with her. So he's talking about wisdom right now. Long life is in her right hand, and her left hand are riches and honor. Her ways are pleasant ways, and all her paths are peace. Right, so Elohim is trying to get the people to understand this. My commands, my structure, is what's going to give the land fruit. When you see Israel, when they sinned, they didn't keep the Shemitah year and the Jubilee. They didn't let the land rest, which gave them that final boot out of the land, right? They didn't let the land rest. They didn't fulfill the command. And so Elohim said, you got to get out. You have to pay for the land, not being resting. Following the command is very important. Following Elohim's wisdom is very important. His commandments are what guides you in the way of the world, distracting you and doing something that might mislead you or put you out of focus. And so this week has Bricha Shah portion with Yeshua, and we're going to read that as well. The Bricha Shah says the following. Yeshua already has resurrected, and so he has appeared to many. He says, while they were telling these things, right, he appeared to them. Let's read that higher here. Behold, two men were going that very day to a village named Emmaus, which was about 7 miles from Jerusalem, and they were talking with each other about all the things which had taken place. While they were talking and discussing, Jesus himself approached and began traveling with them, but their eyes were prevented from recognizing him. And he said to them, what are these words that you are exchanging with one another as you're walking? And they stood still, looking sad. And one of them, named Cleopas, answered and said to him, are you the only one visiting Jerusalem unaware of the things which have happened here in these days? And he said to them, what things? They said to him, the things about Jesus of Nazareth, who was a prophet, mighty indeed, and a word in sight of God and all the people, and how the chief priests and our rulers delivered him to the sentence of death to be crucified. But we were hoping that it was he who was going to redeem Israel. Indeed, besides all this, it is the third day since these things happened. But also some women among us amazed us when they were at the tomb earlier this morning and did not find his body. They came saying that they had also seen a vision of angels who said that he was alive. Some of those who were with us went to the tomb, found it just exactly as the women had also had said, but him they did not see. And he said to them, all foolish men and slow of heart to believe in all that the prophets have spoken. Was it not necessary for the Messiah to suffer these things and to enter into his glory? Now, this is very important because prophetically, the feasts are an image of the Messiah's work. It is believed to that, right? Now, Yeshua is telling them that their unwillingness or understanding of the prophets are keeping them from understanding his mission. This is something that we need to learn because that's what we're trying to do. Or a lot of people try not to do this. They try to forget about the prophets, forget about the Torah, and so they eliminate what tells you that Yeshua or Jesus is the Messiah or the Christ, right? So he's saying the prophets speak of what Messiah was supposed to do, okay? So let's keep reading. Then beginning with Moses and with all the prophets, he explained to them the things concerning himself and all the scriptures. And they approached the village where they were going, and he acted though as he were going farther. But they urged him, saying, stay with us, for it is getting toward evening and the day is now nearly over. So he went in too and stayed with them. When he had reclined at the table with them, he took the bread and blessed it, and breaking it, he began giving it to them. Then their eyes were open and they recognized him, and he vanished from their sight. The Lord has really risen and has appeared to Simon. They began to relate their experience on the road and how he was recognized by them in the breaking of the bread. While they were telling these things, he himself stood in their midst and said to them, peace be with you. Shalom. But they were startled and frightened, and thought that they were seeing a spirit. And he said to them, why are you troubled, and why do doubts arise in your hearts? See my hands and my feet, that it is myself. Touch me and see, for a spirit does not have flesh and bones as you see that I have. And when he has said this, he showed them his hands and his feet, but they still could not believe it because of their joy In amazement, he said to them, "Have you anything here to eat?" They gave him a piece of broiled fish. He took it and ate it before them. Now he said to them, "These are my words which I spoke to you while I was still with you, that all things which are written about me in the law of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms must be fulfilled." Then he opened their minds to understanding scriptures. And he said to them, "Thus it is written that the Messiah will suffer, rise again from the dead the third day, and that repentance for the forgiveness of sins will be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. And you are witnesses of these things. And behold, I'm sending forth the promise of my Father upon you, but you are to stay in the city until you are clothed with the power from on high." 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 19, verse 20 say, "But now Messiah has been raised from the dead, the first fruit of those who are asleep. For since by man came death, by man also came the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all die, also in Messiah we all live, but each in his own order. Messiah the first fruit, and after that those who are in Messiah's coming. Then comes the end, when he hands over the kingdom to God and Father, when he has abolished all rule and all authority and power." Now, this is speaking of the coming Messiah, the prophecies that they are expecting from the future Messiah that's coming for a second time. They believe is once, we understand is twice. Now, let's look at a prophecy, and with this we'll close out, of what Yeshua was speaking of about the prophets, right? That spoke about his coming. One of them is Hosea. Now, Hosea chapter 6 says the following. And I like this translation because it says something very interesting, right? It says, "Come and let us return unto the Lord, for he has torn and he will heal us. He hath smitten and he will bind us up. After 2 days will he revive us. And in the third day he will rise us up, and we shall live in his sight. Then shall we know, if we follow on to know the Lord Adonai, his going forth is prepared as the morning. And he shall come unto us as the rain, the latter and the former rain unto the earth." The latter and the former rain are definitions of the harvest time. The latter represents the spring festivals or the spring harvest, which is Pesach, unleavened bread, and Shavuot. And the former rain represents his future coming, which is Yom Teruah, Rosh Hashanah, Yom Kippur, and Sukkot. Now, all of these things are for us to understand that first fruit are given to Elohim. Elohim gave us his best, his son, the first fruit of creation. Through him, we have access to his kingdom. And he asks us to give him our best, the first fruits of our labor, understanding that we cannot keep the commandment based on the temple because the temple is not built, but we can give them the best that we can and demonstrate our loyalty and our consistency in obedience to his commandments as much as we can based on what is established. Our obedience is key, our consistency is key, and as long as we honor Messiah and understand that in him is that door to his Father, and that he is the first fruit, and that we're called to give him our best, our first fruit, our wealth is only a sign of how Elohim is good if we're obedient and consistent. So that being said, read the Torah portion. You got to get to chapter 27, chapter 28. The curses, the blessings, read them. The curses are very long, so they're gonna take you a little while, but read it, meditate on it, talk to your parents. Have a great week. Shavua tov, Shabbat shalom. Thank you.